this has been a tremendous series. I've enjoyed preaching every week of it. And I pray you've learned something about the Holy Ghost. And I pray that you have developed even a closer relationship, a walk with the Holy Ghost. You know, one of the things that people, and I get it, I understand what we mean when we say it. You know, Jesus is in the room. Jesus is here. Jesus is in me. That's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible says Jesus went away. And the angel said he will come back again the way you saw him leave. But since he's not here, he's sending the Holy Ghost to be with us. You want to know who's in the room right now? The Holy Ghost. You want to know who's in me? The Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is getting me ready to meet him again. The Holy Ghost is getting me ready so that I can get other people ready to see Jesus again. Whether I breathe my last breath or he comes in the clouds, we're going to be ready to meet him because the Holy Ghost has made us ready. Amen? Look at somebody and tell them, you're marked. You got a tattoo. You can't see it. It's kind of like one of those tattoos you used to get when you went to the club. You can't see it unless it gets under the right light. And that's the tattoo you've got on your life, is you can't really see it until you get under the right light. And then all of a sudden you see that your life has been marked by the Holy Ghost in Jesus Christ. It's a mark that maybe you can't see it everywhere you are, but I promise you this, every devil coming against you can see that mark on your life. He sees that the Holy Ghost is active in your life. We talked about what is Pentecost, and I broke down for you Pentecost and the first Pentecost Sunday and what that was all about. And we've talked about being filled with the Holy Ghost and what it means to be filled. Remember that water. Don't ever forget that cup of water. That's being filled with the Holy Ghost. And then I did a message called I've Got the Power. Look at somebody and say, I have authority over all the devil's ability. Let's talk to that. The Holy Ghost gives you authority over all the devil's ability. And who wants a lawnmower that you have to push it yourself? I want one of those that does the work by itself. That's being filled with the Holy Ghost. You've accessed that drivetrain in your life, that powertrain. Then we talked about communication and how the Holy Ghost gives you a new prayer language. A language. You know what's beautiful about the day of Pentecost is there is a way of studying the Bible that people believe if you go to Genesis and start reading backwards, it's like reading in the New Testament forwards. And it's a very interesting study. And one of the things they point out is if you notice in Genesis, there is a tower called Babel. And the people are unified, and God says whatever they put their minds to, nothing will be impossible for them. So God had to come down and confuse their language. It brought division, and it stopped the work. But when we get to the day of Pentecost, God once again comes down, touches those disciples' languages, but rather than division and the work stopping, there is a unity, and the work just begins because they got communication in the Holy Ghost, and you have access to that. But then I started praying about this message on Freedom Sunday, and there was an illustration I did. It's been about 5 years ago, and God took me back to it and began to show me again how maybe it's a great illustration, but there's even more power to it when you realize the importance of the Holy Ghost in your life. You can have a relationship with the Holy Ghost.
Right.
You can talk to the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Did you know that? In fact, in your Bible, there is one of the disciples, his name is Philip. This happens in the book of Acts. And the Bible gives some very, Luke is, again, he's interviewing Philip. And this is what's amazing about this scripture. Philip talks about two accounts that took place in his life. In one account, he said, the voice of an angel spoke to me. And in another account, he says, the voice of the Holy Ghost spoke to me. Here's what was so amazing. Philip had such a close walk with God that he could distinguish between the voice of an angel and the voice of the Holy Ghost. That's how real the Holy Ghost wants to be in your life. He wants you to have such, see, if I'm standing in a room of people today and Kim starts talking, I can distinguish her voice out of everybody else's voice in the room. You know why? Because I have a relationship with her. I know what her voice sounds like. And when you get a relationship with the Holy Ghost, you'll go into situations and you'll hear a voice and you'll know that's not my conscience talking to me. That's not my fears talking to me. That's the Holy Ghost talking to me right now. There will be times that the Holy Ghost will wake you up at 3 o'clock in the morning and say, you need to stop, you need to wake up and you need to pray. You need to get on your knees and pray. And you'll say, oh, no, that's just, no, no, no. That's the voice of the Holy Ghost. And he'll pray because you are holding back a disaster that would have taken place, but you knew the voice of the Holy Ghost. My dad was in a service one night. They were down at 15th and Race, downtown Cincinnati. And in the middle of his preaching, he stopped what he was doing, walked out from behind the podium, went down to the altar and began to pray. Just then, the windows in the building started shaking violently. There was a man just a few blocks down that had lit a match and didn't know there was a gas leak and blew up the entire building. But only one life was lost. You know why I believe that was? Because somebody heard the voice of the Holy Ghost. And my dad told the whole church in the middle of a sermon, we need to stop what we're doing and everybody needs to pray because somebody's life is hanging in the balance. You can get that close of a relationship that you hear his voice when he speaks to you. But understand, if you ignore me long enough, I'm going to stop talking to you. If you ignore the Holy Ghost long enough, he'll stop talking to you. And it is a scary thing when you get to the place that you don't hear God's voice anymore. I want to feel conviction. I want to feel God's presence, and I want to be able to hear the voice of the Holy Ghost because he knows that I'm listening when he speaks. So I want you to look at somebody today and tell them, you're just an echo. You're just an echo. The Holy Ghost has made us echoes. Now, this is the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 18. Pentecost has just taken place. These disciples are out in the street. They're going crazy. They're healing the sick. There's miracles being performed. People are speaking in tongues. They're giving their life to Jesus Christ. And in 4:18, the disciples are called in front of the Sanhedrin. And here's what it says. It says, they called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you, more than God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. You want to get upset at us? You take that up with God. All we can do is speak what we've seen and what we've heard. So they cast him out. In verse 29, the Bible says they get together with their little church group, and here's what happens. Now, Lord, they begin to pray, look upon their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled was shaken. They were filled with the Holy Spirit, and watch, here's the sign, they spoke the word of God with boldness. Persecution hits them. Persecution begins to press in on their life. And what do? They pray. And they say, God, fill us with boldness. And God fills him with boldness. And the first thing they do is start speaking the word of God. Say this with me. I am not a source. I am an echo. You are not a source. You are an echo. Matthew 10:19, Jesus says, but when they deliver you up, do not worry about what you should speak, for it'll be given to you in that hour what you should speak. For it is not you who speaks, but the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. Now, Jesus is talking about a time, and I don't want to get gloomy on this beautiful Sunday, But I believe in America, we are moving quickly back to the place where pastors are going to be put on trial for preaching the Word of God. I believe we're going there very, very quickly. And that's why you need to prayerfully consider who you vote for when it comes voting season. Because if we, I promise you, pastors who are filled with the Holy Ghost will stand in courtrooms and say, I cannot speak what I want to speak. I can only speak what my Father gives me to speak. The Holy Spirit is speaking through me. But if you don't stand in a courtroom, many of you are going to go through a trial. You are going to face trials. And everything in you is going to want to speak defeat and despair and discouragement and fear. But if you hear the voice of the Holy Ghost, rather than curse in the darkness, the Holy Spirit will rise up in you and command the light. And it'll be the Holy Ghost that speaks into you. Am I preaching anybody today? I feel like I'm preaching really good. We must have the Baptist crowd here this morning, the Methodist crowd. You are not a source, you are an echo. What is an echo? An echo is a reflection or a reverberation of sound. If you fill a room, if you have, we have these panels up on these walls in here today, they absorb sound because with all the flat walls in here, the sound would be terrible because of the echo bouncing off of all the walls. I would speak, and then that sound would begin to reflect off of every flat surface. Every echo has a source. When I speak, that sound goes out and begins to bounce off of these flat surfaces. When the Holy Ghost speaks, he's got to have a surface that his voice can bounce off of. So that it is not you who is the source, but it is the Holy Ghost who is the source speaking into you. King David, at the end of his life, there's a chapter in 2 Samuel, and it said these are the last words of King David. I want you to hear some of the last words of King David before he died. 2 Samuel 23:2, the Spirit of the Lord spoke by me. His word was on my tongue. Do you hear what he's saying? I wasn't a source. Don't think for a second that I wrote all those psalms. Don't think for a second that it was me who got the idea one day, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He said, no, when you read that, understand it was the Holy Ghost on my tongue that was speaking through me. His word was on my tongue. He spoke by me. I'm not a source, David is saying. I'm just an echo of the Spirit that is speaking into me. Here is the problem in the church today. We have too many people running around trying to be the source and not the echo. We think we got all the answers. We think we have more to say than God has to say. So we take what little word we know and we begin to beef it up with our opinion, and then we offer it to the world, and we wonder why the world thinks that the church is so jacked up. The church is so jacked up to the world because we got too many sources standing behind the podium and not too many echoes standing behind the podium. We don't need to hear what you say. We need to hear what the Holy Ghost says. It is a source that determines the echo. In other words, echoes don't have a say. Echoes don't get to choose what they say. The source does. Here's the big idea. The echo emanating from your life is a result of the source speaking into it. If all you do is speak division, I know your source. It's not the Holy Ghost. If all you do is speak hate, I know your source. If all you do is speak unforgiveness, I know your source. Because see, none of those are the Holy Ghost. So there must be another source that is speaking into your life. Let me see if I, Blake, grab my speaker and run it up here. Blake's going to help me with a little bit of a illustration here this morning. Turn this, let's test it. And they're getting you a microphone. So let me connect. talk amongst yourselves. Am I connected? Turn the volume up. Turn the volume up. All right, we ready? Now he's gonna put this up. So I know you guys probably have some of these. Check it, check it.
Check.
Check one, two. Check one, two. Check,
check,
check. We're good.
Check.
I know you guys have one of these. It's a Bluetooth speaker. And you know, it's made life so much easier. And when I grew up, I had the record player in our basement. And I remember listening to the Happy Goodmans on this record player. But the record player was the size of like a Corolla. You know what I'm talking about? And you had that, it was like a coffin. You lifted the lid on it like somebody was dead on the inside. So that was the first music device I had. And I remember off to the side of this record player, there was an 8-track player.
Oh, yeah.
8-track. How many's old enough to remember 8-track? You couldn't rewind. You need to share that with your kids. I remember a day when we couldn't rewind. If you wanted to rehear a song, you had to fast forward all the way to the end, start over, and then go back to that track. And then we got cassettes. And listen, I'm sorry, but cassettes were wonderful. I miss cassettes. They were great. And remember when the technology came out so you could like skip songs because it would like listen? That was awesome. And then we had the CD player. I remember when I got my first CD player in my car, but you couldn't drive 5 feet without it skipping because you hit a bump and it skipped, skip, 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 skip. And then we got CD players. And then if you was really cool, you got a multi-disc CD changer, a 5-disc CD changer. You were somebody. I can remember people getting in their trunks, changing out their CDs. Hold on, I'm gonna get in my... You couldn't do it while you were in the car. They kept it in the trunk. And you get that CD and you slide them in like them little cartridges. And now Bluetooth's a big deal. And Bluetooth's really cool. And so I have something that's very special to me. It's called my summer playlist. And when I take the top off the Jeep and I take the doors off the Jeep, man, I go cruising down the road and I'm blasting my summer playlist. Now, I've got some old songs on here. I don't have many new songs. I'm not hip, right? I'm not hip to the jive or whatever you say. I don't know what the cool songs are. I don't know what all the kids are listening to. If I'm listening to it, it was probably really popular about 10 years ago. So I got this playlist, and tell me if you know any of these songs. So here's my summer playlist. We ready? Here we go. Let's see. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here, you can take a break. Wasn't that fun?
Yeah.
See what I'm saying? How about this? Any country folks in the room? Anybody like country music? Yeah. Here we go. You ready, Blake? You ready? Sing it with us.
Sometimes it feels like this world's spinning faster than it did in the old days.
Great song.
It's a good song.
Here we go. What are you gonna do? Are we allowed to play Taylor Swift in church? Y'all ain't ready for this. You ready? You ready? Look at somebody, say, you ready? Here we go. I'm too white for that. Let's have some church. Look at somebody and say, let's go to church. Not church. You want to go to church? Not church. 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 Where is it? Where is it? Here we go. It's great. Because the moment that song comes on, all the black folk know what to do. All the black folk know what to do. White folk are like... So I'm going to help the white folk out. You ready? Whenever you hear a church beat like this, here's for all the white folk. I know you can't dance. Just imagine you got a jump rope, right? Invisible jump rope. And just start. Double duck. That's all you got to do. Look, all the people with no rhythm are like, thank you, Jesus. That's the greatest revelation I got in this whole series.
Oh, I wasn't ready for that.
All right, we'll put on. So we got some worship. Worship. See, here's the point I'm trying to make. We've had a lot of fun here today, but here's the point I'm trying to make. Did you notice that at no point when I hit play on my playlist did the speaker ever tell me no? I didn't play Let It Go and the speaker say no. You know why? It's just an echo of the source that is speaking into it. And when you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, you don't tell the Holy Ghost, no, I don't want to forgive, no, I don't want to love, no, I don't want to be brave. The Holy Ghost says, I hit play, you echo the source that is speaking into your life. Somebody give God a big praise. Notice, play worship. Notice the speaker doesn't give me his opinion. See, when the Holy Ghost tells you to take a step of faith, and you keep turning around saying, I'm sorry, Holy Ghost, I don't have the skills. I don't have what it takes. I'm not qualified enough to take that step of faith. The Holy Ghost says, I'm sorry, did I ask you for your opinion? Or did I tell you to take a step of faith? Come on. Watch this. When Moses is getting ready to go back to Egypt, God appears to him from a burning bush. And he speaks to him and says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses responds to God and he says, God, I'm sorry. I just can't do that because I got a stammering tongue, God. And I just can't speak real good, God. So how do you want me to go stand before Pharaoh, God, and say, and you know what Moses never took into account was that God was talking from a bush. And you're giving God every excuse of why he can't talk through you. And he's over here talking through a bush. You are just an echo. You are not the source. And when God tells you to speak, have courage. It's not going to be you who is speaking, but the Holy Ghost who is speaking through you. High five somebody and say, you don't get an opinion, you're an echo. Look. Isn't this cool? Watch. Isn't that cool? There is no visible connection between my phone and this speaker. But yet none of you are walking around going, now how does that work? That shouldn't work like that. There should be some type of connection between the phone and the speaker. No, you are satisfied to understand that there is not a visible, tangible connection between the phone and the speaker. And this is why the world can't understand the Holy Ghost. And this is why the world will never understand your relationship with God. Because when they're producing hate, you're producing love. And when they're producing racism, you're producing unity. And when they're producing bitterness, you're producing unforgiveness. And they say, how can you do that? That doesn't make sense. They don't see the connection you have with the Holy Ghost. sea. It's a good song right there. You ready? Here we go. Why'd you stop? Let's try it again. Why'd you stop? You're getting it, aren't you? Did you notice the further away I get? Did you notice the further away the speaker gets from the source, he loses the sound? Maybe the reason you don't sound like the Holy Ghost is because you ain't living close to the Holy Ghost. Maybe the reason you don't look like Jesus is because you don't spend any time with Jesus. Maybe the reason you don't act like the Holy Ghost is because you're living too far away from the Holy Ghost. High five somebody and say, you're just an echo. Take the mic off. Come out here real quick. Let me see. This is good. This is good. Here you go. Ready? I'll fast forward a little bit. It's a good song right there. Watch. The sound did not change based on his situation. Did you notice it doesn't matter if he's standing up, there's worship, and it doesn't matter if I push him down, there's still worship because his situation doesn't change the sound that is coming out. Worship God in this place today.